Thank you all for attending. This is the December 8th meeting of the Cabrillo Unified School District Board of Trustees. The board met from 6:01 to 7:03 p.m. and took no action. We also had a public session prior to that from 5 to 6. It's a special work session for the board. Sorry, get on the right page here. So the first order of business is to have the Pledge of Allegiance. And is there anybody in the audience who might want to lead the Pledge of Allegiance? Jump up fast. Okay, I'll do it. Oh, Michael will do it. So we'll have trustee. Okay. I'd like to take the podium and the mic.
Okay. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Trustee Ahern. So I need a motion to adopt the agenda as presented.
I motion.
I do have a second.
I'll second.
Well, thank you very much, Trustee Livingston. So all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Trish? Aye. Thank you. So then the next item of business is the oath of office ceremony, item 9 on the agenda. So this will lead off with special guest Ann Campbell presenting the oath. Should we have both trustees? Trustee-elect Stan? Jane, you're going to lead it?
I'll lead it.
Okay.
So I'd very much like to welcome this evening. This looks ridiculous, me hanging over my phone. So I very much, and I have to do this. I can handle this room, but the TV hasn't. So I very much would like to welcome and thank for her graciousness the superintendent of San Mateo County Schools, Ann Campbell, and she has come to administer the oath of office to our two brand new board members, Kimberly Hines and Sophia Lane. Sophia, sorry, my brain just went. And so I'm going to let Ann do the ceremony. So, ladies.
In administering this oath of office, I just do want to say to
We'll try again. There we go. Good evening. And prior to administering the oath of office, I do want to express my gratitude to the Cabrillo Board for your service over the years, especially the two board members who are departing. One of the things that I most appreciate about going around the county and administering the oath of office to new board members is, to me, as people take this oath of office, it really represents the very essence of our democracy in America. And I think that there is no better expression of our democratic process than the work that local school boards do, because you really are having a direct impact upon the children and families of the communities that you serve. And I know that those of you who are experienced in this could tell these two delightful individuals who are about to step into this role that this is the kind of role that it is impossible to make everybody happy all the time. And so the best anchor that you can have as a board member, and certainly is the one that we have as educators as well, is that is the decision that I'm about to make the very best one that I can make for the students in the school district that I serve. So thank you to all five of you for your work together as a governing board. I watched you from afar and have definitely appreciated your work, and it's certainly been a pleasure to work with Jane as well. So I would like to invite both Sophia and Kimberly up to the podium, and we will administer the oath of office.
So what we're going to do is I'm going to say aye. When I do that, you guys sit down, and then you each say your own names.
Okay. Right. Okay. So raise your right hand. I,
Sophia Lane,
Kim Hines,
do solemnly swear or affirm.
Do solemnly swear or affirm
that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
And that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith.
That I will bear true faith.
And allegiance.
And allegiance.
To the Constitution of the United States.
To the Constitution of the United States.
And to the Constitution of the State of California.
And to the Constitution of the State of California.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation.
Without any mental reservation.
Or purpose of evasion.
Or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully.
And that I will well and faithfully.
Discharge the duties upon which I am about to enter.
Discharge the duties upon which I am about to enter.
Congratulations, you do that very well in unison.
Yeah, I'm going to call you. Thank you. Next, I'd like to ask Superintendent Euster to invite our two departing trustees up to be recognized.
So, someone from Senator Hill, Jerry Hill's office, was also supposed to join us tonight with two proclamations for our outgoing board member, but somehow the traffic seems to have gotten to her. But when we get them, we will most certainly send them to you. But I would like Kate Livingston and Michael Ahern to please join me at the podium. So I have, thank you. Michael, and let me get out of the.
Thank you.
There really aren't words to describe the selfless service that school board members give. And our board, we are remarkably lucky here in Half Moon Bay to have such a proactive board with so many board members who just give and give and give. And Kate and Michael, 4 years of service, everywhere, all the time, listening, acting, reacting, all for the benefit of children. I've had the privilege of working with them for a year and a half, and it has been a great, great privilege. Thank you for your selfless service. Thank you for always being willing to step forward for what's right, even when it doesn't always feel like it. Thank you, and congratulations.
Thank you very much. Now, at this point, it's time for cake. Please join us in the lobby for refreshments. We convene here. Yeah, I know. I'm going to get a fine down. And there's no coffee. Yeah, it's obvious. Where's that control? There we have it. Okay, getting started again. We're on item 10, which is a governing board reorganization. This is probably the most important thing that I, as president of the board, will do for this year. And that is to hold the election to determine governing board officers and designate their our representation to, and appointments to different localities. So I need a motion to move ahead with the governing board reorganization.
I'll make that motion.
Thank you. Okay, and the first item of business is to elect the president, so I would open the floor to nominations for president of the board.
I would like to nominate Freya for president.
Do I have a second to nominate Freya McCammon as president?
A second.
Thank you. All in favor? That was roll call for, we'll start with trustee.
Aye.
Aye?
Aye.
Okay.
Aye.
Thank you. So five plus one, president. So that ends my service as president of the board, and President McCammon will take over.
Thanks, Kurt.
How many people does it take?
I do it myself.
It's a self-service kind of thing. Okay. Thank you all for the patience and understanding. We will get it all organized soon. So now we move on to... Not yet. To the board vice president position. Do I have a nomination?
I'd like to nominate Rob Cabrillo, vice president.
I'll second.
All in favor, roll call. Should we start with you?
Aye.
Aye?
Aye.
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 Great.
And we need to change the markers again. It's all very official. Now we get to the clerk of the governing board.
Need a nomination?
A nomination, please.
I'd like to nominate Sophia Lane.
Second?
Second that.
Okay. And a roll call, we'll start with you, Kim.
Aye.
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 Great, approved.
All right.
Great. And so secretary, so we need a motion for that as well. So the, in general, the secretary to the board is...
Everything else would be in mass.
Oh, is in mass.
This is an appointment?
An appointment. Okay.
And then they motion and second your appointment.
Okay. So in general, we have our superintendent as our secretary to our board. So I'd like to appoint Jay Newser as secretary of the governing board. Do I have a motion?
We can do that at the end.
Yeah.
Okay.
So move.
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
That passes five plus one. Moves us on to authorizing signatories for the governing board. So the clerk of the governing board and the secretary are generally the signatories. Can I have a motion to appoint those? Second?
I'll second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Sophia Lane as clerk to the governing board and Jane Newster as superintendent and secretary. Freya as president?
And Freya as president. Oh, I forgot about that one. Do we have another motion?
No.
It's okay? Okay.
For the record.
And then the following, we will take in mass. We will designate who is the different spokesperson, representative to different bodies around the area, and school site representative. So we will decide all those and then vote on those in mass. So the first person is the board spokesperson. Traditionally, the board president is the board spokesperson.
Second.
Okay. And then we need a representative to the county board of education. Does anybody have any interest in doing that? Okay, Sophia Lane. The next is representative to the San Mateo County Committee on School District Organization. I'm happy to do that. Representative to the San Mateo County School Boards Association. Representative to the City Council of Half Moon Bay.
I'll do that.
Kirk.
representative to the Midcoast Council. Okay, we actually deleted the Measure S Steering Committee. That's no longer an active campaign. Representative to the Cabrillo Education Foundation. Rob has been doing that.
Right.
Interest or?
Maybe interested in that.
Okay, Rob. Representative to the Chamber of Commerce Education Committee. I'm happy to do that one.
Great.
Kate's description of it was quite.
Yeah.
And the next gets to the representative of school sites. And I propose that at a future time, we talk about more of the details of what that means. We can put that as a discussion item for the January meeting where we talk about what that responsibility entails. For now, we'll just do the assignments. So Hatch Elementary. El Granada. Farallon View. Oh, I'm sorry. Sophia Lane is Hatch. El Granada is Kim Hines. And we're at Farallon View. I'm happy to be Farallon View. We haven't, yeah, we're at, yeah, sorry.
It could be great if you do it.
Sure. Always like going back there. Kings Mountain Elementary. I have been the site rep for quite a while and it's a wonderful place to visit. Highly recommend if anybody would like to try. A little further trek up the hill, but. Rob? It's a great graduation. Cunha? And the high school. Is that good or did you want high school? You can also both.
I don't even know one time.
Yeah. You want to just put you both down? You guys can work together on that?
Sure.
And Pilarcitos?
Pilarcitos.
Kirk? Great, did you get all this, Patty? Sorry, my voice is so quiet. I'll try and speak louder. Great, so now we need a motion and a second to approve all of those.
So moved.
I'll second.
So first Kirk and second Rob, all in favor?
Aye.
5+1, great. We are officially reorganized. In terms of our structure, moves us to the other part of our reorganization. Every year after we reorganize, we're going to approve and adopt the 2017 Governing Board meeting calendar as required by our board bylaws 9100. So do we have any issues with the, I know that one of the meetings was changed already, Jane, to accommodate your schedule.
Right now, make sure you have to move
okay.
The February meeting day because I'm the superintendent.
So several of them are not the second Thursday of the month, the one in January, the one in February, the one in April, the one in June. We do two in June to make state budget and LCAP and other approvals. We tend not to have one in July unless it's necessary. The rest are all the second Thursday of the month. Does anybody have any conflict that they know of at this point with any of them?
I do not. Not for me.
Potentially December 14th.
Okay.
Certainly you're not going to.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely not going to be.
We can, because we can change it, we can try December 7th. Is there a reason to have it at that particular time?
This 7th.
Would that work for everyone else? Want to check? I don't plan that far ahead, so
yeah.
I'm good. My calendar's all blank.
Is it still in session the following week?
Yes.
Yes. We're later in the packet, we'll be adopting the calendar for next year. It gets out around the same time, the 21st, 22nd.
Yeah.
Is it on the 22nd?
Yeah.
What's the date for?
Thursday, 7/14/21 in December. 22nd.
Wait, when's the day the high school gets out?
Monday break.
Last day of school is the 22nd.
Yeah.
But so
the reason it sits the day it sits is because we have a Thanksgiving break
Oh, for the board packet out. So it's the 7th too, much of a push.
7th, really. Just leave it on the 14th.
Okay. Great. Okay, so motion to approve and adopt the 2017 Governing Board Meeting Calendar?
All motion.
Second?
All second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, great. So that moves us on to item 10C, which is to complete our annual review of Board Bylaw 9250 as it pertains to compensation and to whether or not we may elect to reserve, to receive service for members of the Governing Board for 2017. Compensation and also benefits, right?
Yeah.
So do you want to talk about that, or do you want me to?
I think you should do it, because it's a historical precedent that this board chooses to do.
Okay, so traditionally, this board has chosen, we are authorized by law to pay ourselves, I think it's $240 per month, and historically, this board has passed a policy, which is still in effect, which we donate that money back to the district. We don't take any compensation for our service. We consider it a volunteer act that we do for the community as a whole. So this is an opportunity for the current board to discuss whether or not they want to continue that policy. If we choose to change it, it then has to come back at another late, at a later date to actually be changed. So that's been our tradition. So just, it's not a motion or anything that we need to approve, just kind of a discussion at this point about whether or not we want to continue with that policy.
I propose we keep it there.
All in favor? Okay, it's not a motion, so, but we're all in support of not being compensated for our work here. Oh, we do need a motion?
Motion.
Okay. Sophia's motioning, Rob the second. All in favor?
Sophia and Rob.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Okay, great. That takes us to item 11, which we don't have any tonight, so it takes us to item students, recognition? No, we don't have anything. Yeah, no, takes us to item 12, which is comments from the public related to items not on this agenda. I just want to remind everybody that we love to have people come and speak to us at meetings, remind you that per California state law, the California Sunshine Act passed sometime in the 70s, we are not allowed to comment on or engage in a discussion about any item that is brought to our attention that is not officially on our agenda, and that is to protect the interest of those that might have an interest in hearing or discussing that item and wouldn't have known that we were going to be discussing at that time. So that's why when people make comments, we can't have a discussion about what their comments are. But we really do appreciate it when people come and make comments to us, but we just want to explain that before folks come up and talk to us. So we have three folks who would like to make a comment. Kyle Kohler, would you like to come to the stand, please? Do you need his address or? Welcome. You pressed the little button, the little voice, yeah, there you go.
There we go.
Magic.
Good evening. How are you guys?
Good, thank you.
Well, let me start by saying that I want to thank the board members for their time, as well as for all the work this passionate collection of citizens has done to support and enrich our public schools. I want to thank you and the Cabrillo District in their wisdom for allowing me to work in a wonderful city with world-class students, and for some of the most inspiring and effective administrators in the country. Half Moon Bay High School's excellence is a direct reflection of your efforts and its community. I'm here today because an increasingly large number of employees have been hired since the tiered healthcare system was created in the 2010 and 2012 agreement, and I'm one of those teachers. Having missed the first tier window, I and every teacher hired since has been faced with an increasingly difficult list of decisions to make. Half Moon Bay, being the magical community that it is, also comes with a considerable increase in the cost of living. Now, I know you've heard these figures before, and they are just as indefensible as they were last month when Lane Mullen stood at my place. Rent along the coastside and over the hill has risen 53% in the last 5 years, which makes it the task of finding housing for under half of our monthly income nearly impossible. The cost of extending my health benefits to a partner would be over $600 a month. The cost to care for my future son or daughter would soar to $1,100 a month. The tiered, multi-tiered healthcare agreement seems to have been made under a very different set of circumstances than what we find ourselves in today. I've worked for Half Moon Bay High School for 4 years, and I, like many of the most talented teachers who work there, came straight from the credential program. I've treasured every moment here since. I love my job. I thank my stars every day for it. I've learned so much here. Working with the teachers of Half Moon Bay High School has been one of the great privileges of my life. Iron sharpens iron, and I've worked with the best. I've had every opportunity afforded to me by my brilliant administrative team, and now as the chair of the ELD department, I sit on the other side of the interview panel. I hire people. And it isn't news to anyone. It's hard to hire here sometimes. Summer's an ugly time for us, and with high teacher and administrative turnover, and with the drought and qualified teachers coming, it will only continue to get worse unless Cabrillo Unified seriously considers restoring full family health care insurance. It is common for teachers to bust their chops at a school district, only to leave after a few years in search of a district that can provide for them and their families. We are one of those districts that teachers leave. We don't offer competitive pay in comparison to other districts, and coupled with the increased cost of living here, so many prospective teachers come hoping for the traditional advantage of working in education, comprehensive health benefits, and they find none. We can address this issue, or teachers will continue to migrate to less desirable schools in pursuit of compensation that guarantees a sustainable way for teachers to grow families and thrive in their communities. Our discouraging rate of teacher turnover is undeniably a product of a discouraging benefits package. There's no way around it, or benefits package is disappointing to new teachers. I've seen high caliber teachers interview for competitive schedules and then decline the job directly afterwards because of benefits. I've seen high caliber teachers accept positions at our site and then rescind their interest due to compensation in other districts. As a matter of fact, in many departments have learned that it is best to offer jobs to incoming teachers within 48 hours of the interview in hopes that they don't communicate with any other district. And even then, we needed to offer positions 3 times over the course of this last summer. And years before that, it was 4 times. Full family health care will impact our entire staff and every prospective teacher looking for employment. Teachers would be proud of the compensation they receive for their work. Knowing that their family was supported and protected by a full health care package is a powerful thing. The kind of thing that keeps people happy in their jobs and around. And while we have seen small increments in increase in pay, we are slowly increasing our pay and will continue to stay behind other schools because of the fact that other schools are also increasing their scheduled salaries. This is a tremendous opportunity for us to stand apart from other districts. Lane Mullen was present amongst you last month with the same concerns, and possibly tonight, and I implore you to consider them. We know it's hard to provide for a family, and it should be. It's a man's job, and a worthier enterprise couldn't be found, but it could be a little bit easier. Everyone present in this room believes that education is the silver bullet. Education is everything. We don't need little changes, we need gigantic, monumental changes. Schools should be palaces. The competition for Teacher of the Year should be fierce. Teachers should be making six-figure salaries. Schools should be incredibly expensive for the government and absolutely free of charge to its citizens. We haven't figured out how to do this yet, but this would be a good place to start. Thank you.
Vanessa Stubbs.
Thank you for your time this evening. As a teacher in Cabrillo Unified, having solid health benefits to rely upon helps us to offset the fact that we have one of the lowest salaries in the county. Our lower salary and the fact that Half Moon Bay is relatively remote to many other cities on the peninsula means that other benefits, like our supportive community and health benefits, cannot be compromised. How are we to attract excellent seasoned teachers if we do not offer benefits for their families? If I wish to start a family, unfortunately, I will have to move to another district where I will be able to support them. I ask that you please consider this issue holistically and do what is best for those who do what is best for our students. Thank you.
Thank you. Lane?
Hello. Congratulations to our new board members. I would like again to thank the district for the opportunity to teach in Half Moon Bay. I would also like to acknowledge those teachers who have come before me. To teach in this district is sadly a secret that much of the Bay is still unfamiliar with. Many do not know the students, teachers, and support that can be found in this seaside cove. I was embarrassed last time I spoke to those gathered last we met. I assumed there was little support for the cause of healthcare for those before me or those behind me. I was wrong. I knew I was wrong then when I heard the cheers and the communal support from my peers. I knew I was wrong later when school board members expressed their sympathy and desires to help newer teachers. I know now that there's even a desire amongst some administrators to extend benefits to newer teachers. It seems like there's little opposition to what we know is right. What we know is right is to extend the opportunity of family health care to teachers that were hired after 2011. I use the word opportunity because it's not something everyone will take advantage of, but it's something that everyone or all have earned. Whether we add an opposite sex or same-sex partner, whether we adopt or bring our own children into this world, this is an opportunity that should be extended to all those who do the same job. As one teacher put simply, it's not equal pay for equal work. Some said that other districts have rid themselves of family benefits. To them I say, since when is "but they did it too" a good excuse? Adults, teachers, and parents know better. I've also heard some say, you may have to consider if this is a good fit for you here. To them I say, I'm not going anywhere. This will be my job long after you leave. And let's be honest, no one's in favor of a two-tier system. There are those in favor of achieving some modicum of equality and coverage, and thus removing the two-tier system. And there are others who are content to keep newer teachers out, to hold the door closed until the last senior teacher has left, leaving a legacy of nothing for the future of teachers at Half Moon Bay. Gaslight districts have popped up on each site in the district. There are those who have told me and others, this is the way it's been for 10 years. This is the way of the future. Nothing can change, but things can change. What cold equation accounts for your wife, but not mine? This child, but not that? How do we determine that we have just enough funding for you? Surely the district saves money by not covering many dependents, but what will be done with these savings? What comes from liquidating the liabilities we have for the families of others? How can we be happy with anything? May I continue to speak? How may we be happy with anything purchased at the expense of an increasingly large amount of husbands, daughters, sons, and wives? It is no joy being on the outside looking in, but it is of some comfort I'm not on the inside pushing out. I'm almost done. We have had at least one raise since I've joined the district, and we will undoubtedly have another before I leave. This is something that districts and unions regularly negotiate, and I've been the beneficiary of said negotiations. It'd be nice to benefit from a raise that would outstrip the $1,100 a month expense to cover a family, but I expect that will not happen. And given this unlikely blessing, it still would not be equal work for equal pay. No one has to be against family health care. I invite others, as I did in November, to stand with us and lend their brave voices in favor of this opportunity. My name is Lane Mullen. I teach at Half Moon Bay High School. I'm asking for family health coverage.
Thank you. That takes us to representative reports. Item 13. A. Kathy, Sean, or Sean, are you speaking? Welcome.
Thank you. Congratulations, Freya, and welcome to Sophia and Kimberly. I want to thank you now for the hard work and heavy lifting you'll be doing for the next 4 years to keep our district moving forward to serve the needs of all of our students. I want to report that negotiations have been long and hard and painful, and every day I'm in there I enjoy my classroom that much more, but they've also been really productive, and I think I do think that we're working toward a competitive compensation for similar districts in this area. Speaking of long journeys, the high school has just voted to adopt a modified block schedule. And yay. Long enough, though, I went onto my computer to look for, I can't exactly remember what document it was about block schedule, and in Google Drive, the first one that came up was from 2009. So maybe negotiations are speedy and efficient in comparison to that. So looking forward to tying up the negotiations in the next meeting or so, and thank you for your time. Congratulations to the new board members. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. CSEA representative, Diane.
Congratulations, Freya.
Thank you.
Welcome to Kimberly and Sophia. I'd like to say good evening, President McCabot, Superintendent Euster, board members and administrators. CSEA is sunshining our letter for negotiations in this evening's board packet. CSEA would like to thank the board and the administration for the four reclassifications recently awarded. We are hopeful many of our classified members will be acknowledged with like salary increases. Thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you. Brings us to item 14. There's two actually, are on reports, information, and presentations. The first is he here?
Yes, he's here.
Okay. The first is the receive the Measure S Facility Bond Citizens Oversight Committee 2015-16 annual report.
Yes. Thank you. I would like to introduce Mr. Phil Hoffman, who is the chair of the Measure S Bond Oversight Committee.
Welcome, Phil. Thank you.
How are you?
Thank you for your service. Good.
Welcome. Good evening. Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to present.
Is it on the screen?
No, it's not.
Oh, okay. I'm trying to figure out if we're supposed to move or not.
I was going
to
say, I didn't prepare anything. So.
Where's your PowerPoint?
It's a trick screen.
Okay, go ahead, Phil.
Sorry,
thank you.
Try again. No worries. Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to present to this board, superintendent, and cabinet, as well as members of our Halfway Made community, the fruits of our labors as a Citizens Oversight Committee, the Measure S Facilities Bond Annual Report to the Cabrillo Unified Governing Board. My name is Phil Hoppan. I am the Measure S Facilities Bond Oversights Committee Chairperson and a parent of three young boys in the Cabrillo Unified School District. As it reports on our website, Measure S is indeed an $81 million bond measure to improve education in our schools on the coast. And it is our oversight committees who provide a significant measure of accountability to those very same voters with our oversight of the use of the funds for appropriate expenditures. The Measure S provides the Cabrillo Unified School District the opportunity to complete basic classroom repairs and equip all schools with updated learning technology and science labs to prepare students for college and careers, including efforts to replace or repair leaky roofs, keep schools clean, well-maintained, and in good condition, perform essential safety repairs and maintenance on classrooms and facilities, to update, as I said, classrooms and science labs, equip classrooms with 21st century technology, improve fire and earthquake safety, and to renovate school restrooms and replacing aging and inefficient heating, cooling, and plumbing systems. The bond includes many fiscal accountability measures, including a citizens oversight committee, an annual third-party audits. No funds can be used for administrators' salaries, benefits, or pensions. Every penny of these funds are used to improve schools in the Cabrillo Unified School District. No funds can be taken away by our state. The measure qualifies as well our school district for future state matching grants, which would be otherwise unavailable. The work of the committee this year built upon the work of past years by reviewing and scrutinizing our own bylaws and operations, by having rich conversations with this district administration, who are present at every meeting, around the successes, possibilities, and challenges as well facing this district's capital projects. The committee for the first time toured district facilities with an eye to future inspections of the work this district has asked the committee to support. The community to support. And we continue to insist that this committee sit with a third-party auditor who reviews the district expenditures related to Measure S to review, line by line, every page of the audit, annual audit report. Our work goes beyond flipping to the page where it is articulated that no findings in this year's audit, though that is always pleasing language to see for some of us, yes. As this auditor poured over 80% of the fiscal documentation related to the work done with Measure S funds this past year. As such, this committee voted upon and approved our annual resolution to include the following. Whereas, pursuant to its desire to assure greater school community that these facilities bonds will be expended only for the school facilities project listed in the bond project list, the governing board established this Measure S Facilities Oversight Committee. Whereas, as well, the Citizens Oversight Committee reviewed detailed independent performance and financial audits. Whereas, this central purpose of the Central Oversight Committee is to inform the public at this annual written with this annual written report. And now, therefore, be it resolved that the Measure S Citizens Oversight Committee has met and reviewed detailed independent performance and financial audits. Please accept this audit report, or this annual report, to include a record of our committee's proceedings and the activities and detailed reports around expenditures, and a copy of that third-party audit. The report articulates our findings that indeed 2015-16 Measure S review revenues were indeed expended only for school facilities projects. This report, appropriately so after its adoption, will join the public record on our website. Of the past 4 years, working with fidelity to honor the original bond language and the intentions of the community of the voters who supported the measure ballot. While the report today speaks to our primary charge to be transparent and to provide oversight, what is most exciting about our work is something we can all enjoy as we walk our children to school and see Hatch Elementary School under construction, when we drive by in Kelly Avenue and see the wonderful and now honorable buildings that will house our Placitos Alternative School, as we try to avoid traffic accidents with our fellow citizens further east on Kelly as we try to sneak a peek at the massive and awesome project that is our new gymnasium. As we know and feel secure that students are learning in modern 21st century classrooms behind secure doors armed with Columbine locks, using instructional technologies as well that engage students with 21st century tools. Thank you for receiving this report. Thank you for being so supportive of our work to honor the intentions of our community of voters as we preserve our reputation as fiscally responsible and transparent district interested in the main thing, that is increase the student achievement and healthy academic lifestyles of our students, teachers, staff, and parents that they deserve. Thank you.
Great, thank you very much, Bill. Really appreciate your presentation.
Absolutely.
Happy to receive the report. Appreciate the hard work the committee has done to follow through on that commitment to the community.
Absolutely.
And also an appreciation once again at these moments to thank the community for the for the faith that they've given in this district in order to have the $81 million in bonds in order to do these construction projects that are desperately needed. So
that's great.
Really, really appreciate you and the community for all
Absolutely.
That you've done. So thank you.
For
Any
sure.
further comments from the board on
Thanks for serving and the
Absolutely.
Thoroughness of your efforts.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having me.
I appreciate the very thorough and actually very enjoyable presentation. On a subject that is not always the most exciting. You really do a lot to it.
Each year I'll bring a little more to it, maybe. We'll see. But
much appreciated.
Thank you. Appreciate that, sir. Absolutely.
Great. Thank Wonderful. You very much.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
Have a great evening. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you,
too.
Folks.
Thank you for being here.
You bet. Absolutely.
That takes us to item 14B, receive the first interim budget report.
Patty, is there a trick I should know?
Yeah. No. Watch your back.
I'm too tall. Yeah, that's it. Right.
They say that it's the I think there's a lot of Christmas songs that talk about being the most wonderful time of the year, which starts off one of my many financial reports of the year, known as First Interim. Let's see if we get this to work here. Okay, so this is First Interim, which is one of two interims throughout the year, one of four actual financial reports that are presented. The interim reports are a status of the overall financial health of the district. The interim reports must include a certification, which is either positive certification, qualified certification or a negative certification. I'm happy to report that for this first interim of the 16-17 school year, we do have a positive certification, which means that we will meet our liabilities, our expenditures for this year and projected to out years. So in business services and with the financial reports, we often maneuver within two actual fiscal years. So why we are doing first interim budget, we are actually doing the audit report for 15-16 of last year. Second interim is about the only time that's a singleton that we're in actual 1 year and not operating in two fiscal years. And then we move into the budget season where we will be adopting the 17-18 budget while working on the 16-17 estimated actuals. So significant changes since the budget took place back in July and the talk around the state. The mandate reimbursement has decreased about $23 per ADA, which equates to about $73,000 for Cabrillo. This is really important to note because as the state over the past couple of years has started to offer districts one-time money, the difference of this one-time money over each year has been significant. So in 15-16, we received $1.7 million in one-time money. In 16-17, we will receive just under $700,000. So there is a very large difference. They say it's related to the revenues that the state receives, but they come up with a different thing to say every time. So we'll find out in January what they're going to say about one-time money, possibly for 17-18. But there has been discussion that what we thought was a trend of one-time money is now not a trend and is on its way out. So it'll be very interesting to see what happens in January. The 16-17 revenue projections are down from June. The state is still not addressing the STIRS and PERSES increase that are affecting all districts statewide and will become a perfect storm for Cabrillo in 18-19. The state is forecasting a mild recession in 18-19 due to the decline in the stock market in 2018 with a fairly quick recovery in 19-20. I don't really think that we're going to see anything as declined as funding here with the implementation of the rainy day fund that they have at the state level. I think our funding will stay fairly steady. LCFF is on pace of implementation, but it does vary by state scenario. So that's going to roll back up to what they feel is going to happen with a possible mild recession. The district was on track to be fully implemented actually next year, but they have recalculated our target and we're back now on target for 2021. So with federal funding, it continues to remain flat. And our IDEA funding, which is the majority of our special ed funding, 40% of that funding is supposed to come from federal dollars, but we actually only receive 16%. So to kind of equate that into numbers, our special ed budget's about $6 million. 2.4 is what we should be receiving, and we receive under $1 million. Now with the transition period that's going to occur in Washington, I just hope that it's as smooth as our transition that we had here tonight. So the planning factors that go into first interim are listed above. We see that in 16-17, there is zero COLA. 17-18 is a small COLA, 18-19 gets a little larger. It is important to remember that when LCFF is fully implemented, that districts will only receive increases based on a COLA. So if we were fully implemented today, we would be receiving zero increase for 16-17. The gap funding is slowly getting closer to 100. You see the dips were 54% of the way this year. They up it next year, and then we come back down. But again, we're still on target for 2021 now. The STIRS employer rates, you see as those go up and how 18-19 is so much larger. It equates to about $1.4 million difference between 16-17 to 18-19. So this is just the gap overall. Again, that quick change. That change that said that Cabrillo was supposed to be fully funded in 18-19, actually for LCFF, happened and then changed in literally less than 6 months because it was just a amendment on our funding calculator that we get. So I was surprised to see that and then not so surprised to see it go away. I am happy to report that there was an increase in the lottery. It is now up $4 than what it was before. I have not seen that change in 20 years, so I thought that was pretty interesting. And then the one-time funding we do see at the 214 versus the 503 that we saw last year. So this is just a quick snapshot of basically what our multi-year projection looks like with our revenues and our expenditures. We actually are doing really well here with our balance of a budget. This is about as close as we've come to a balance of a budget in the past 8 years that I've seen from my research, and definitely in the three that I've been here. So it's definitely showing some strong, healthy reserves. Which leads us on to just a specific reserves page. So by law, we are required, by state statute, we are required to have a 3% reserve. It is important to note that a 3% reserve would not even cover one payroll. So what we've done with some of this one-time money that we received is definitely prepare us for what is up and coming, especially in 18-19. With the LCAP carryover, that's related to what our minimum proportionality percentage requires us to be, which is related to supplemental funding that we receive in the LCAP. By full implementation of the LCFF funding, we must reach 100% of our MPP. So sometimes the LCAP may fall short of reaching our expenditures, what is budgeted, we possibly don't hire, we may not implement an action attached to a goal for whatever reason, but it's important to know that that supplemental dollars that was assigned for that year needs to eventually be spent on LCAP. So it's very important to make sure that we are marking that LCAP money, because when we're fully implemented in 2021, let's say we will definitely have to be implementing those dollars into actions and services. We also have the textbook adoption, $400,000 we have assigned, and that's for the new science standards. And then our deferred maintenance of $100,000 to help service the facilities that we currently have and that we will be building. Again, this huge hit for STIRS and PERS increases. So this adds a little bit of projection and cushion that we will see again in that 18-19 when we get about $1.3 million hit for STIRS. Restricted programs is just your standard. So what is left on the bottom line that's unassigned is $1.2 million. Again, pretty strong numbers for the district, but it is imperative that we remember that the reason why those funds are there are due to one-time dollars. So past, present, and future, we cannot forget the most recent recession. Our bond rating, the companies assess on our cash, which actually looks really good right now, which is great because later in this meeting, you have a resolution to approve to sell and issue some additional bonds. It's important for us to maintain our flexibility through what we have learned from the past. And the large gap funding that we've seen in previous years will definitely yield to smaller year-over-year funding in the future. So it's really important that we watch those funding levels as we commit to future expenditures. And just my closing thoughts, again, in our projection years, it's very important to know 3 years, although 2 years out seems like it's far away, and a lot of changes can happen. You know, we can prepare as best we can, but it actually is around the corner. And next year, those 2 years out, that third year out in those 2 years, I will not be able to include our parcel tax. So it's already getting to that time again when we have to really consider, going back out for that parcel tax renewal and what our books actually look like if we don't get it. So again, a special attention must be paid to those out years. I know they're kind of boring. We just want to look at what's in front of us. But I really would like to emphasize how important they are. Any questions?
Can I just make one point before we leave? And I mean, Crystal has said it, but if you hear us keep talking about closing the gap in funding and achieving our full funding, I remind you, as she said, it takes us back to 07, 08 funding levels by 2021. I just cannot emphasize that enough. And I mean, if we could tattoo it somewhere up here, I would. 07, 08 funding levels by 2021.
Thank you, Crystal, for your presentation. Thank you, Jane, for reminding us about that. I was thinking that as we were looking at the presentation. And it's amazing how many people don't understand that outside of this room. So it's important to repeat. So it moves us to discussion items. We're going to discuss, it's 15A, the first reading of new course proposal part 2 for the Half Moon Bay High School. Is John leading that, or are you going to lead that, or is it Joy? Sorry. Tiffany's just going to.
I'm back again.
Thank you, Tiffany. Please welcome.
Hi, Tiffany Zammit, assistant principal.
Yeah, press the little make it turn. Keep your finger on there.
Got it. There we go. Nailed it. Good evening. I'm Ms. Zammit, the Assistant Principal of Curriculum and Instruction. Thank you for having me back for a part 2. I'm really thrilled to be here to present one more course. It was a little bit of a struggler, but our amazing teacher does so much, and I'll introduce him in just a moment. So our course is Introduction to Music. This is a course that's going to be open to students 9 through 12 at the high school. For students, big picture, who haven't necessarily picked up an instrument in their lifetime and decide that they want to at the high school level. The pathway, or this class, will continue to support the pathway at the high school. It will be A to G. It's an F categorized course that'll be in our fine arts program. I listed within our PowerPoint as part of our rationale and some of the National Association for Music Education's really reasons and benefits for music programs in high schools, and why I think it's so great that we still have ours, and I want to keep it and make it even a little more robust. But it aids in language and reasoning, mastery of memorization, increased coordination, builds imagination. It aids in fighting stress, which, as we talk about health and wellness, these are all good things, great things for our students. At this point, I'm gonna also welcome up, they're working with an experienced teacher who's doing wonderful things with our music program. The reason this took us one extra board meeting to get here is that Walter and I need a little more time to get our ducks in a row. He, you know, does everything with our band that is so amazing, a lot with Cunha's band, and balances both of those. And then he's also in the middle of our musical auditions. So he just does so much. And so I'm gonna welcome Walter Anderson up to the podium with me. Walter. So Walter is the teacher. I'm like, yes, he deserves applause, of our music program. So he'll assist me if there are additional questions. But this course is going to allow for students, like I said, to enter the pathway. Currently, our freshmen come in to our concert band class. But in order to make it into that class, they have to have gone through the music program at Cunha. We're introducing this because we'd really like to open the course or open the pathway to our students at the high school level, even if they haven't necessarily picked up an instrument yet, and this would afford them that opportunity. So are there any questions before I keep talking and Walter's here?
I have a question. Yeah. So what gave us the recognition of the opportunity for this? Were there kids that you were talking to who showed interest but had never had the opportunity?
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah,
as expectations about how easy this will be to fill and so forth. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, there are many students at the high school who've expressed to me an interest in taking music classes, but there's this idea of, you know, like, yeah, all the students in the marching band class have been doing this, some of them since elementary school, many of them take private lessons. And so there's this learning curve, and I've tried to mitigate that somewhat by being like, you know, join marching band, you can play cowbell, but I mean, you know, there's something to be said for building up, you know, good
you know, fundamental literacy skills and experience of music history and, you know, actual technical proficiency on an instrument before they join a larger performing ensemble. So that's part of it. And then also, you know, they're, you know, we have really busy students, and there are a lot of activities available to them, and some of them start taking, you know, music lessons, or they're in the bands at elementary school levels, and then when they get up to the middle school or the high school, sometimes they choose another avenue, and many of them, by the time they're older, juniors or seniors, they have the time to revisit those activities, and they, you know, they want to, but it's not always an enticing opportunity to just jump right back into the marching band. So this provides them with that opportunity. And then also, you know, for the students who are already enrolled in the music program, you know, a class like this will do double duty. You know, if a student wants to reinforce their historical or theoretical knowledge, they can take this course if they have the time. And it will help build up those skills that will then reinforce their playing ability in their performance class.
Thank you.
Really great idea.
And from a scheduling standpoint, we do have students ask our counseling team all the time for this sort of, well, can I do music? And now they can, because, you know, we've had a little bit of trouble working them in if there isn't the experience there. And so this will mitigate that. So just to go quickly, it'll continue to increase our first-generation college going via elective offerings. It is still A to G. It expands our music offerings and, like I said, hopefully continues to build a sustainable program. We really love everything that Walter does and want to build out his program. So fiscal impact, a single section, class set of theory workbooks, which will all be covered through the REO, our site funds. This is what the music pathway will look like once the intro class is in there, and it can kind of fit in at the course one level or the course two level, but it allows for students to kind of enter from the sides.
So, in the introduction to music, will it be both choral and instrumental?
So part of the idea for the course is allowing students to choose, you know, and select the instruments. Obviously, you know, they're going to be able to work on multiple instruments throughout the process. But, you know, the workbooks that I'm planning on using, there are resources available, for example, both treble clef and bass clef. So if a student wants to play trombone, there are a set of, you know, work exercises that approach from that perspective. And, you know, for high voice or low voice, you know, there's also approaching from that perspective. And it's a sort of a holistic approach of theory and the historical background, and then applying those in a practical way to the instrument of their choosing. If they choose voice, that's totally acceptable, yeah.
And they would actually be able to go straight from the introduction to music into jazz?
Well, jazz does, on the books right now, require concurrent enrollment in another music class. But yeah, that's the idea. Assuming that they get to that point, jazz is still audition only. So if they pass the audition, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it might be a good recovery class.
Yeah, totally.
Students that are starting to go like that.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Great.
Okay. Thank you all very much for your
Thank
time
this
evening.
Thank you, Tiffany. Thank you, Walter. We really appreciate it. We'll see you again in a month for the adoption. Thank you.
That brings us to communications. Board members. Some of our veterans like to start, or our news?
I'll start.
Okay.
I'll be pretty brief. I just want to welcome Sophia and Kim to the board. Really look forward to working with you. Enjoy getting to know you both before, so I think you're going to fit into the team quite well, so welcome. The only other thing I wanted to make was relative to Crystal's comment on budget. And having worked on the last couple of parcel taxes and with where the state's heading and potentially federal, I think the community needs to appreciate that we will need to become a bit more self-reliant, is my assessment. And our current parcel tax is only $150 per parcel, which was far below what we really needed to do, but that is what our survey showed that community members would vote and support for, though they far outstripped what we expected in the positive vote for it. And I guess I'd like to start messaging that we'll need to do a larger parcel tax next time around if we're going to solve any of these issues, because no one else is going to come help us. Jane already called out the funding, where we're going to end up when we're at full funding, frankly, is a joke. So get ready. We, community, your district needs you, and it's good for the kids and what we're all about. So that's on my mind.
Great.
Go ahead, Sophia.
Sure. I just want to say thank you for the warm welcome. It helps with the TV.
Yeah, and I usually have the loud voice too. Just want to thank you to everybody for the warm welcome, and Dan for the swearing-in ceremony, and everybody for already making me feel, and Kimberly as well, speak for you on this point, you know, really, really at home. It's a great board to be joining, and a tremendous district, and I'm really proud to be able to give back to our community in this way, and really, really thrilled to be here. So look forward to partnering with the folks in the years to come.
Thank you very much for the warm welcome, and it's a steep learning curve, definitely. Already I've got many questions, and I know that there's lots of possibilities open. I concur with Rob's interest in let's start paying attention now to parcel tax. And I think also, to the extent within our community, we can pay attention to what's going on at the state level, that perhaps we can find a way to reach beyond our immediate district network and hopefully have some other broader influence in the long run. Years ago, when I first started teaching, there was a quote I had in my classroom right out of college, and it was our greatest national resource is the minds of our children, Walt Disney. It's such a pleasure to see how our teachers honor that, and I'm a recent empty nester, and having graduated two students from Cabrillo Unified School District, it is a pleasure to be an advocate for students. And Sophia and I spent 2 days at the California School Board Association convention Thursday and Friday, so of last week. Some of the themes were that I found very meaningful were building trust and communication and relationships, as well as healthy school boards. And it's a pleasure to feel like I'm coming onto a board that's already operating in a healthy way. So I look forward to getting to know more people within the district, and thank you.
Thank you, Kim.
I'll make it brief. I just want to again say farewell to our trustees that have gone on. It was great working with them, and I really look forward to working with our two new trustees. The board has a lot of work to do, and I appreciate the enthusiasm that's evident from the get-go. Hopefully that'll be sustained, expected. It's a great time of year, isn't it, with the year winding down and a lot of things in the air, and it just gives me a pleasure to be part of a group that's really, I feel like we're accomplishing a lot every day, and not only by riding on the laurels of the efforts and the enthusiasm of the teachers, but just putting our minds together and looking forward to ways we can improve our situation. It's just feels good to be involved in this, and I enjoy every month these meetings, believe it or not. Not the meeting so much, it's just all the discussion about all the wonderful possibilities. So let's keep that going. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Kirk.
I want to as well say welcome to Sophia and Kim. I'm looking forward to working with both of you on the board. It'll be an exciting opportunity to continue what we've been doing and add in the new energy and enthusiasm that you're both bringing. So thank you very much. I forgot to kind of say a little bit earlier about our restructuring, and it's maybe seemed a little bit pro forma. We'd already figured it all out, and that's because we had, because we actually have a board policy about how we rotate our positions on the board so that every year we get a new board president, we get a new board vice president, we get a new clerk, and it's set out in our board policy how those rotations are made. And we did this a couple of years ago so that we were already kind of doing that prior to that, but we felt like it was really important to set it out in policy so that it was clear what the next steps were going to be. And we do that because we really govern as a team. It's really five of us. I'm the board president this year, but that doesn't really mean much more than I run the meetings and I meet with Jane about some of the agendas. And then next year it'll be Rob running the meetings, and we share in that governing with Jane. So I just want to kind of mention that. I also want to thank all the school sites that have welcomed me. It's been a pleasure to meet with the principals and to sit in the staff rooms and talk with teachers and staff, whoever wants to come in. I am going to be coming to Pilarcitos in February. I will pick one of the dates, Raj. We're going to wait until they've moved into their new digs, so that'll be really nice. I really love these opportunities to come to the school sites to talk to principals one-on-one and to be open to talking to any staff that want to come in and chat and eat. And sometimes we talk about serious issues, and sometimes we just talk about, you know, what our kids are doing. So it's quite nice. I want to also say we did have another meeting. Kate had started meetings of PTO presidents. So Kate and I would meet with them twice a year, and they've been really helpful. And with Kate gone, we actually changed the format somewhat, and I spoke with the PTO presidents that I met with a couple of weeks ago about formalizing the structure, and they were all very excited about that opportunity. So we talked about kind of the three goals of those meetings, being one, that I can communicate with all the PTO and booster heads or other board members, whoever wants to come in that board role, and then also they can communicate back to us issues they might be having at their site. And the third and kind of really exciting part of it is that they can coordinate together and network and figure out what are commonalities amongst their sites. So we're going to try and make those more uniform as well. So that was a very productive meeting. And I do want to second what has been said here about the funding tonight. It is a little bit beyond our control in the state, and of course we can try and do what we can to influence that, but we also need to make sure we're taking care of our own, and we'll need to look to the future in that. But a big thank you to this community already. When I look back at my 6 years on the board with a parcel tax renewal and a bond pass, we've been very, very happy to have the support of this community, very blessed. So I really appreciate the community and all that they do. So that's all for my comments. Jane? Oh, student first, sorry. I have to get back into the schedule.
All right, so I'll start it off with Cunha. They just celebrated their accomplishment of attaining their PTO's annual giving drive fundraising goal of $50,000. Last Friday, their students and staff were treated to an inflatables and game day for their fundraising efforts. And tomorrow night is actually their winter dance from 6:30 to 9 p.m. And from what I've heard, it'll be well attended with the leadership of Mr. Cox and his leadership program. And they'll wrap up their month with the reindeer run and then head on to winter break. Pilarcitos, this is their second time participating in Night of Lights. The staff and students sold student design wreaths and sweatshirts, goodie bags for young children, and also inflatable reindeer and penguins. They're looking forward to celebrate this semester's graduation. And also, they're happy to welcome counseling intern Lauren Hicks to their counseling team. They're excited to move into their new facilities this January. Fairlawn View seems to have had a busy November. They held their traditional winter festival. They performed songs, and they did also arts and crafts with food present. And they'd like to thank their parents, teachers, and community for their support. Moms Against Poverty also expanded their Food for Families program to Fairlawn View and Los Litos, in addition to Hatch last year. They would also like to express their gratitude to Superintendent for supporting their extended kindergarten program and extended academic center. For half Moon Bay, we may have lost Skull Game, but we are CCS champs. So, I mean, that doesn't say much. Like mentioned, musical preparations have started with auditions happening this week and callbacks being announced tomorrow. There will be two band concerts next week, Monday and Tuesday, starting at 7 p.m. So if you would like, you can hop in on one of those dates and check out the music and singing. We are, both staff and students are preparing for finals, but we are still in the holiday spirit and trying to give back. So we are having toy drives and coat drives. So if you have any used coats or new toys you'd like to give to our community, you can drop it off in the office. And there should be bins starting next week. Yeah, thank you so much.
Great, thank you, Trish. Superintendent Euster?
So listening to the commentary from our student representative about all the wonderful things taking place, particularly striking to me is the graduation ceremony, she's referring to it, Pilarcitos, and they will have mid-year graduates. It causes me to reflect on the true reason all of us are here, is for those graduations. For children who enter as little ones, and who graduate ready to take their place and to move forward in achieving of their dreams. And that graduation ceremony, if you've not seen the Pilarcitos or been there, is truly a special thing. It's an amazing occasion, and it is remarkable, both the mid and the final year graduations, to see the children, not children anymore, I'm sorry, they're adults, to see the adults spread their wings and fly. It is something that I think about at this time of year. All of the work, all of the effort, all of the hours kind of disappear when the students arrive on stage and accept those diplomas. Then it doesn't really matter how many hours we all spent on it. If you have not been to a Cunha dance either, I will be there Friday night. It's an incredible thing. The entire school shows up. Most dances, like 100 kids maybe. Nah, Cunha, 700 kids show up. And so it's an incredible thing. And you hear the music concerts and dances and all of these things. Please enjoy this season. Enjoy our children. Enjoy the wonderful things our communities and schools do for our children. A huge thank you again. I cannot thank the parents enough for entrusting this school district with their most valuable and precious gifts. And this is a great time of year for us to celebrate that. Thank you.
Sorry, I forgot to turn mine on. Takes us to item 17, consent items. Do I have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Five plus one. That takes us to items 18, action items. 18A, approve new course proposal part one for Half Moon Bay High School. And these are the advanced video production, wood technology one, construction technology one, and construction technology two. Is it your joy?
Do you want to do it, or do you want me to do it? So these are the courses that were, I'll do it.
Okay, so, your name's not there.
No, but it's simple.
Yes.
So these courses were brought to the board per the board policy. They were brought for discussion last board meeting, and now they are brought for action for adoption, and so we can put them on the schedule for next year.
Great. Do I have a motion to approve?
Second.
Any discussion or comments?
Kim.
Any discussion or comments? I just want to again say I'm very excited about these new courses and the new CTE pathways that we're doing at the high school. So I'm very excited to be approving these courses tonight.
I think these are really exciting. I was going to ask, so maybe I didn't ask that clearly last time. You list all these possible qualifications. There's a long list of things that could be covered in the classes, correct? And you keep that an open list because for flexibility, or because you're not going to cover all those areas, I think. Would you clarify just what the plan is? Yeah.
I'm losing my voice this week. I'll just yell from the back.
So the standards that were listed on the actual forms are standards that meant to actually be covered in the class. So it's not, they're not necessarily a variable or flexible. Those CTE standards are pulled from the actual pathways from CDE that are for those pathways in those courses that should be covered.
So all of those things will in fact be covered?
Yes.
It's a lot.
It's a lot. Yeah. It is a lot. That the whole, especially in the construction with the interior, the exterior, and all
yes.
of that. Yeah. I mean, but that's what makes the pathway so awesome and robust. And it is over the course of not just 1 year. That's why it's a pathway. And so you're building upon it from year to year.
Fabulous. That's great. Because, they didn't come through clearly last time.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's, you go through that list, you can't believe it. It's everything.
But it all ties in together, and they're building walls that are
dirt to
foundational.
Shingles,
I mean, everything is building upon the rest.
Great.
So, yeah.
Okay, thank you for clarifying.
Yeah.
No problem.
Thank you.
Great. Any other comments or questions? Okay. It's not a roll call. No. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's 5+1. Thank you. Takes us to item 18B, approve the 2017, 2018, and 2018, 2019, we're planning ahead, student teacher calendars. I think that's you, John.
Thank you very much. And yes, indeed, it's a mouthful. We are bringing to the governing board this evening for approval the 17, 18, and also 18, 19 school calendars. This is a labor-intensive process behind the scenes. It does involve formal negotiations where we sit down, the district sits down, if you will, with CUTA, the Teachers Association, and CSEA, and we negotiate the calendar. I would like to thank Diane Paoli, the CSEA president, as well as Kathleen Wall, the chief negotiator for CUTA, for participating actively in this process. We also needed to include, of course, the ratification process, that both associations bring the draft calendar back to their associations, and both calendars were overwhelmingly approved. We did not have a lot of sample calendars to work with because very few districts even have 17, 18 available. To my attention, only the Sequoia Union District has 17, 18. So we are definitely planning well ahead. If you note, the sample calendars are enclosed within the board packet. And while I'm not going to review every date and every break, I will begin by noting our start date. Return date for August 2017. As we have in the past, we begin on Wednesday, August 16th for a staff development, and then we have two work days that follow staff development. We have a negotiated agreement that includes four work days, the other one in January and the other work day in June, and our first day of school is August 21st. And that is always the question when the phones start to ring. When do we start school? Planning the summer holidays. So it'll be great for our community, our parents, to have these calendars pending your approval posted. You can quickly see through September, our holiday on the 4th. We had great discussion with regards to the October and having two non-school days on the 6th and the 9th. And of course, transitioning into Thanksgiving, I believe for the last couple of years, we have not had school during the week of Thanksgiving, which I think has been favorably received by not just staff, but parents and students as well. Transitioning into December 2017, you can see our last school day on December 22nd. Returning in January, we begin with a work day. That's the transition between the first semester and the second semester. And I think one of the biggest changes in the history of the calendars is that the semester for the high school used to end in the second or third week in January. Mm-hmm. And that was very concerning, problematic, and we worked our way through the negotiation process to have the first semester end in December, bringing a more appropriate closure for students in December. And you'll see that reflected in the calendar as well. Transitioning into February, not sure why it's always called Ski Week, but frequently called Ski Week, the week of the 19th. You'll see March is a full month. We have the spring break the first week of April before we transition to the finish line, if you will, in May, and concluding in June 2018. The last school day is the 14th with a work day on the 15th. And also included within the packet, the 2018-2019 calendar, which is very, very similar in the months of August, beginning the school year, transitioning again into the October, November holiday, December holidays. And as you can see, we still maintain our breaks just with different dates in the month of February and April, and then conclude in June as well, June 13th. So again, I want to thank Kathleen Wall and Diane Paoli. This was a very tight timeline where we were literally driving ballots from the sites to the district office. I'd also like to thank Rosie Acosta and the Pupil Services Department, who really, really is the point person at the district office for this humongous task that involves a lot of coordination. So this evening, we are presenting the calendars to the governing board for approval.
Thank you, John. Do I have a motion to approve the calendars for 2017-2018 and 2018-2019? Okay, Kim, second?
I'll second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
It passes 5-1. And that takes us to item 18C, hold public hearing for the 2016-2017 contract reopeners as submitted by the California School Employees Association and the Cabrillo Unified School District.
Thank you. Also presented this evening will be, after holding a public hearing, we'll begin the negotiation process with CSEA sometime in January of 2017. As you can see listed in the green sheet, if you will, the cover sheet, we will be discussing Article 5, hours and overtime, Article 6, salary, Article 8, health and welfare benefits, Article 10, vacation. Duration article also includes the opportunity to open up one additional article, which for the district will be discipline, and for CSEA will be promotion. So upon your approval and after the public hearing, we will be able to begin the negotiation process with CSEA.
Great, thank you. So I will open the public hearing on the CSEA opening. Are there any comments on the CSEA opening letters and Cabrillo Unified District opening letters? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing. We don't need to do any kind of motion then. Okay. That brings us to item 18D, approve the first interim budget, 2016-2017.
Yes, as presented earlier and this time, every year must be submitted to the County Office of Education before December 15th, on or before December 15th. I ask that you approve the 2016-17 first interim with a positive certification.
Great, thank you. Do I have a motion to approve? Second? Any comments or questions? We already had the presentation, but any further? Okay.
I think we're tired.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Very good.
Aye.
All in favor? 5-1. 18E, adopt resolution number 2216, authorizing issuance of Series C bonds under the Measure S Facilities Bond Program.
This is always something to be so excited about because it lets us relive that moment when the district and the community was able to get the passage of Measure S with that $81 million. So I'm very excited to see us go for yet another round, which will be Series C for $20 million of our $81 million. In our bond sales. So we are right on time. We are right on target as far as keeping our promises to the community within that limit that was stated on what will be the measuring factor of the actual bond and how much will be charged. So I'm pleased to see that. And so this starts a long process. It takes about 3 to 4 months before we actually get the money, but the market is doing quite well right now. I have our bond rating meeting on December 14th, and I am predicting a double A rating again, which is very good for us. We look very healthy as far as the bond sales go. So I bring you Resolution 2216 to authorize the issuance of Series C bonds under the Measure S Facility Bonds Program.
Great. Thank you, Crystal. Do I have a motion to approve?
So moved.
I'll second that.
Great. And is this a roll call vote, Patty?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Rob?
Aye.
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 So passes 5+1. Thank you. Takes us to item 18F, approve intent of lease-leaseback agreement with Block Construction. Is this you or Crystal? Crystal Lee.
I believe it was last month or the previous month I brought you the intent to approve the mechanism for the lease-leaseback contract method for the repair of Cunha C Building. Tonight, I bring you the intent of the lease-leaseback agreement. While we are in negotiations with Block Construction, they have been chosen as the firm to conduct the repair of C Building and the library, but we will first start with C Building. They are a firm that the district has vetted and worked on two projects now with them, and we feel that they are the most qualified and best fit for this repair of C Building. I do have our project manager, Dean, in the audience if you do have any questions. Again, this is the approval of the intent in January. We will be bringing you back the GMP, which is the guaranteed max price, and a firm contract.
Great, thank you. Do I have a motion to approve? Okay. Second? Second. Okay. Any comments, questions, discussions?
We're very glad to see that we're moving ahead, at least as fast as we can within it. But it's going to be done in a very careful process, and just can't be soon enough for me.
It can definitely not be soon enough, and it's unfortunate, but it's excited to see it moving in the right direction.
Second. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Passes 5+1. And that takes us to future board agenda items. Receive the Measure B program report, which is our lovely parcel tax, which we appreciate so much. Receive our technology report. I'd be excited to hear about all the technology that Measure S has funded already in our schools. We'll receive the report on our local control accountability plan goals 3 and 4 at the next January meeting. Receive and accept annual independent audit report. Discuss the plan for block scheduling at Half Moon Bay High School, which will also be in January. Approve the lease-leaseback agreement with Block Construction, which will be in January. And approve the new course proposal part 2 for the Half Moon Bay High School. Future events dates, we have, as was already said, the Cunha Dance tomorrow, Cunha School Site meeting coming up on Monday, the Health and Wellness Committee meeting coming up a week from then the final exams at the high school. No? Okay, not that. Okay, the Pillar Cedars Winter Graduation Ceremony will be December 21st at 10 a.m. Do we have a member of the board that would like to attend the winter graduation?
I'd love to, but it's the 21st.
Sorry. Okay, Sophia Lane would like to attend.
And you.
Okay, the two new board members. So that is December 21st at 10 a.m. And it will be here in the district office. Is that right, Raj? Okay. And then December 21st is the last day of classes before winter break. And everybody have a happy, healthy, safe holidays and a wonderful break. And we actually are recessing to closed session, but we'll say goodbye to the public. Sure. Can we have a motion to go past 10?
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Yes, we should try not to try.
Like, sir, aye. I'm leaving.